Hey everyone. So after having gotten introduced to the course and after having seen the various packages that you can use for the analysis of social networks, I'm sure you might be all geared up to learn the concept from social networks. I would say if you only learn the concepts from this course and don't apply them to real world situations, you might not be able to gain enough understanding. So it is important that whatever knowledge you acquire, you apply them to real world scenarios, and for that purpose you obviously need the data sets from the real world situations. Now, how do we get that data? Fortunately, there are various individuals and organizations who have gathered network data sets for different situations and topics. And the good thing is that they have kept this data online, publicly available for anyone to access and analyze. Moreover, these data sets are available in different formats. So in this video, we are first going to take a look at the formats into which the data sets are available. And after that, we are going to look at the sources from which we can download these data sets. And then in the subsequent videos, we are going to analyze these data sets which we'll download from the internet. So let's get started, and before we get into the formats of these data sets, I want you to take a look at the networks on which data is available. Of course, they are not limited. We have data sets available on diverse range of topics. I'm just going to give you a few examples of networks over here. So we have friendship networks, where the nodes are people, and there will be a link from one node to the other node if these two people are friends with each other. Similarly, we have road networks, where the nodes will be cities, and there will be a link from one node to the other node if these two cities are connected through a road. So usually these friendship networks and road networks are undirected networks. And if you look at directed networks, we have email network, where the nodes will be the people, and there will be a directed edge from node A to node B if person A sent an email to person B. Another example of a directed network is a citation network. So you might be knowing that in a scientific scenario, if a paper uses some information from another paper, then this paper cites the second paper. So that sort of information is captured by a citation network. So this is of course a directed network. Another example of a network from scientific domain is collaboration network. So scientists collaborate with each other for some research project or some scientific development. So this sort of information is captured by a collaboration or co-authorship network, which captures that which two people collaborated with each other or co-authored for a paper. So these were just few examples of networks. We are going to come across a number of them on different topics. So as I said, these networks are available in different formats. Let's take a look at these formats one by one. So we have CSV format, we have GML format, we have PAGIC format, we have GraphML format, we have GEXF format. So I'm going to take these networks one by one. I'm going to tell you the basic features of these formats and the basic structure that the files of these networks carry. So apart from these formats, you might also come across some 2-3 more formats, but these 5 are the most commonly used formats. When you download some data sets from internet, that might most likely be in one of these formats. So we're going to take a look at these formats in detail. We'll take them one by one. Let's see what is CSV format. So you might be knowing that CSV stands for comma separated values. This file will be in the form having the extension either .txt or .csv. Now CSV format file can have two more types. It could either be in edge list format or it could be in adjacency list format. So if you are from graph background, you might know what an adjacency list means and what an edge list means. Anyway, I'm going to give you an example of both these formats. So let's see what is an edge list format. You can look at the simplicity of this file. This is a snapshot from one of the files which is in CSV format, which is an edge list type. Here, every row contains two values. First value is the source node and the second value is the target node. So this row indicates that there's going to be an edge from 0 to 344, 0 to 345, 0 to 346 and so on. So basically, the file will contain a list of the edges. And in case you want to add some weight to these edges, you can also do that. For example, you want to add weights to these edges like this. You can add a third value to every row. So for example, the edge which is going to go from 1 to 2 should have a weight 0.3. So you can add it like this. However, there is one limitation that the edge list format carries, and that you cannot add non-numeric weights to the edges. You cannot change the labels. You cannot change any attribute. You cannot add any attribute to the nodes and edges. So that is a limitation that this format carries. So there is a you can see that there is a trade-off between the simplicity and the flexibility that a format provides. Let's now take a look at the adjacency list format. So this is a snapshot from a file which is an adjacency list format. You see every row is having more than two values. Now what does this indicate? The first value in every row is basically a source node, and the subsequent values in every row are the nodes which are adjacent to this source node. So this first row indicates that there is going to be an edge from 1 to 2. There's going to be an edge from 1 to 5 and 1 to 7. And if you go to the second row, it indicates that there's going to be an edge from 2 to 4, 2 to 6, 3 to 1, 3 to 4, and 3 to 7, and so on. So basically, every row tells all the nodes that are adjacent to a given node. So this is the adjacency list format. Again, you can see the simplicity that this format provides. However, this format does not give you much flexibility. For example, you just cannot add any sort of attribute or label to the nodes or edges. If you want to add some color attribute to the nodes or edges, you cannot do that. So it all depends on your requirement. Let's go to the next format. The next format is GML format, which stands for Graph Modeling Language. Now this is one of the most commonly used format for network datasets. The reasons include the flexibility that this format provides when it comes to labeling or assigning attributes to the nodes and edges. Also, this format is not very complex. Let me explain you the format of this file. So you start with the graph keyword, and then you start the square bracket, and inside that you have node keyword, and then you again start the square bracket, and then you write the keyword ID, and then you write the ID of that node. You close the node and so on. You keep adding the nodes. So if there are some n nodes in the network, there are going to be n node keywords. Once the nodes are done, you start with the edge keyword. So again, you start the edge square bracket, and then you write the source keyword, and this is the source node, the ID of the source node, and then you write the target keyword, and then the ID of the target node, and you close it, and so on. So if there are m edges, there'll be m edge keywords like this. That's the simplest format of a file which is in GML format. In case you want to add some labels to these nodes and edges, you can do that as well in this format. Let me show you an example for that. So here you see we are adding a label to this node A. So you can see the syntax. You go inside the node keyword, and there you write this keyword label, and then you write the label of that node, which is node A in this case. Similarly, to write the label of the next node, you go inside that and you write the label keyword, and then you write the label that is node B, and so on. You do this for all the nodes individually, and similarly you can do the labeling for the edges. Again, you use the label keyword, and then you write the label for the edge, which is edge B2A in this case, and so on. So this is how you add labels. And in case you want to add some attributes to the nodes and edges, you can do that as well. Let me show you an example for that. Here, You see, this is a graph. This is the starting of the graph, and inside this there are two attributes here, which are the graph attribute. So apart from node attributes and edge attributes, there are graph attributes as well. In this case, there are two attributes, hierarchic and directed, and these are the values of these attributes. To set the node attributes, you go inside the node and then you start this attribute that you want to assign, and then the name of that attribute and the value of that attribute inside the square brackets. So this is the syntax. So basically here they are assigning x and y positioning to the node. Similarly, for the next node, they are assigning x and y positions of the second node. And here, for adding an attribute to the edge, again you start another attribute and start the square brackets and then assign the value of that attribute. Now here at this point, let me tell you one thing. In case you are just making use of the data sets downloaded from the internet, you might not need to go into the details of whatever I'm just now explaining. So only in case you want to create your own data sets, only in that case you should know these intricate details that I'm telling. Otherwise, you shouldn't worry about these details. I just want you to be aware of the syntax, so that in case you come across some file, you should be able to make sense out of it. You should be able to know what these labels and keywords mean. In other cases, you just want to download the files from internet, you might not need to go into all these details. Okay, let's go to the next format now. We have PAGIC format, which many people use for network datasets. This kind of format has extension .NET, and let me tell you that in some cases you might also find networks with an extension .paj. That also indicates a PAGIC format network, so it doesn't make any difference. So you would have either .NET or .paj format networks, and the way of handling and the syntax is completely the same. So let me show you the syntax of the file, that is the structure of the file. So you will start with this keyword star vertices, and after that there will be a number written, which basically means the number of vertices in the graph or the network. After that, you would have on every row, you would have these numbers 1 to up to n, and after the number you would have some string written, which basically indicates the label of that node. So you see that for every row you have every node written. And once all the nodes are done, you start with the information about the edges by writing either star arcs or star edges. This will basically come below it. Okay, so every row contains the source node and the target node and so on. So this is the basic syntax of a PAGIC file. And there's one more thing that I should tell you. In case there is no labeling assigned to the vertices of the network, you just don't write anything below this vertices keyword, because that doesn't make any sense. You just write the, there's no need to write the nodes consecutively 1 to n. So you just leave that blank, you just write the number of vertices that the graph contains, and afterwards you start with the details on the edges, and that's just the same. And in case you want to add some attribute to the edges, you can do that as well. Let me show you an example. So here, this is the source node and the target node, and then you have some value written. This value basically is an attribute for this edge. So in this case, it's sort of a weight assigned to this edge. So that was about the PAGIC format. So the next format is GraphML format. ML here stands for XML. Basically, you might be knowing what XML format is. This basically provides a hierarchical structure, and it makes use of various tags just like HTML, and that's how you store the details in the form of tags. So in a GraphML file, you would have a number of tags. Let me quickly tell you about these tags. So initially there'll be an XML tag, and after that you would have this GraphML tag, and inside the GraphML you would have graph tag, right? And after the graph tag you would have a number of node tags. Once the node tags are done, you would have a number of edge tags. So this is the basic structure. Now let me get back here to the GraphML tag. Here you see some namespaces and details. Basically you see some metadata. You might be knowing the advantages of using namespaces and all, that they allow different users to use different names, and as long as they're making use of different namespaces. So I don't think you need to get into all that. This is just a metadata about this network. You can start from here. You see a graph tag, and then you have an attribute of graph, which is edge default, which is undirected. And then you have node, you have two nodes here, and you have one edge here. So this is the source and target keyword that you use inside the edge tag. This is the basic structure of a GraphML file. You might feel that the structure is a little complex, but the flexibility that it provides in terms of assigning attributes to the nodes and edges is quite better than as compared to other formats. So let's take a look at one more example from GraphML, where they are assigning attributes to the nodes and edges. So after you're done with this GraphML tag, you start a key tag. This key tag, for example, is for nodes, and this is for assigning colors. And after that, you have another key tag, which is for edges, and that is for assigning weights. And once you're done with the key tags, you start the graph tag as usual. And when you want to assign an attribute to a node, you start a data tag. And inside this data tag, you have you make use of this key, that is D naught. You're making use of this key, and you're assigning green color to this node. In the next one, you're assigning a blue color to this node, and red color, and so on. Similarly, you're assigning a weight 1.0 to the edge by making use of this D1 key. You're assigning a weight 1.0, and so on. So this is how you assign attributes to the nodes and edges. So that was about the GraphML format. Let's go on to the last format in our list, which is GEXF format. This stands for Graph Exchange XML format. This format was basically created by Gephi people. Gephi is an open source software which is used for visualizing and analyzing social networks. So this format is again inspired from XML. As you can see, it is composed of many XML tags. So you start with an XML tag, and then you start with GEXF tag, and inside that tag you have this meta tag to store the metadata about the network, and then you start the graph tag. Inside the graph tag you have nodes tag, and inside the nodes tag you have all the nodes, and then you start the edges tag. Inside the edges tag you have all the edge tags. So the format is little similar. It's actually quite similar to GraphML format, the previous one. This is a little cleaner in terms of assigning various attributes to the nodes and edges. So there's one thing that I would like to point out here. So I want to say that don't worry if you're not understanding anything out of this video, because the aim of this video was just to introduce to you the main formats into which datasets are available. And in case you're not creating your own dataset, you might not ever need to, you know, get into all these intricate details. In case you're just using the datasets downloaded from the internet, you might not need to yourself write all these details that I just explained to you. So the aim was just for you to know, you know, get introduced to these statements, and in case you get a file, you would be able to make some sense out of it. That was the only aim. So don't worry if you don't understand these intricate details.